Thank you. And I will be speaking to Scott Schumacher here, who has 18 years of development and leadership experience at places as diverse as Google and his own startups, and most recently has been VP of Engineering for 3 years at Credit Karma. And he's going to be telling us his experiences with working with non-technical executives and what you might be able to take away that will help you in your adventures therein. So, Scott, let's start with a disaster. So tell us a story about when it didn't work, that you, in your career, when it didn't work, when you had that moment where you are looking at somebody and they're not understanding you and you're not understanding them and it's just not going well.
Yeah, sounds good. I have a bunch of those, which I think is the benefit from everyone here. You can learn from some of the mistakes I made. So this is about 2 years ago, and to give everyone context, Credit Karma had like a 8 or 9 year old monolith that was built in PHP. And the monolith was millions of lines of code, and we started to sort of push towards, you know, moving towards some services. At the time, that was kind of a big investment, and I remember I was went to talk to the CEO to sort of convince him that, hey, we really need to fund this. This is an investment we need to really need to make. And, you know, he's like, services, what? Mono, what? You know, I don't understand any of these things, because he's a CEO. He's really smart, but he's a finance guy or a business guy, really great business head, but no understanding of tech. So my naive approach is like, well, let me just try and build an analogy for you. You know, imagine we're going to basically make this big investment and build a factory. And once it's a big initial investment, but once the factory's built, we can churn out widgets really fast. And he looked at me and was like, I don't want to make a big investment. I don't know what we're building yet. I refuse. I forbid you to build services. Like, it was totally screwed that process up.
Excellent.
Exactly.
So that's the moment when you look at somebody and they go, I have no idea what you're talking about. Okay, so in retrospect, given your experience now, what 1, 2, maybe 3 things do you think you should have done better or you can do better in those situations?
Absolutely. So I think there's two big things, and you can think of these as takeaways, right? So the two things you want to think about when you're trying to influence a non-technical executive, one of them is empathy. Can you understand what motivates them, what's meaningful to them, what matters to them, and figure out a way to connect the work you're doing to what they need? And the second is credibility. Do you have credibility not just as a leader in your area, but also on the areas that maybe, you know, go outside of engineering that you're influencing?
So, okay, those sound good. So empathy. So how do you generate empathy for the CFO who is staring you down and, you know, doesn't understand what you're talking about?
Well, so a big part of it, so there's a lot to this, but a big part of empathy is actually understanding really why the things they're saying matters to them. So I think about this, and you think about engineering. If you're trying to influence another engineer or another engineering team, a lot of times empathy becomes natural because you kind of understand the same pain points. You have the same vocabulary. You have the same language. Right. You know, when you're dealing with someone who's outside of engineering, they don't speak your language. And so you're going to need to spend some time as a leader to understand what matters to them as an organization. So for example, the CFO, after a little while you realize, okay, one of the things that CFOs care about, they care about the top line, they care about the bottom line. And they think about, so then you're starting to think through, okay, is the stuff I'm doing, can I actually figure out a way to tie directly to top or bottom line and help them sort of understand what matters to them? Another analogy to think about is if you've ever been in, anyone here has actually worked in enterprise, in sales you're not talking necessarily about the technology you have, you're asking them what problems you have and how can I help you solve them. So a lot of it is just really digging in, asking a lot of why, like, you know, like a 5 whys to really get down to the heart of what their problem is.
Yeah, so that reminds me of a metaphor I use sometimes, which is, you know, you can look at a corporation as a bunch of different tribes, and they have different, not only do they have different language, they have different religions, they have different things they believe, they have different rituals. So the kind of communication that happens in an engineering department is very different from,
Absolutely.
For example, a sales department. So you have to look at, you know, if you're going to go and influence sales, you probably have to go and be a little positive, a little jolly, you know, and point out that we're going to make more money.
Absolutely. So I think it's, when you're starting off, you don't necessarily know what those look like. So you can just focus on each individual and invest more time actually getting to know them, understand them.
Right.
I've had people where I've actually just tried to understand their background more just so I can contextualize their work. Over time, you start to see patterns that lets you sort of develop some more shorthand. Going back to the CEO, eventually what we realized was, you know, he kind of indicated in the conversation, he valued speed of iteration. And so, you know, when we finally came back around the conversation around services, what we realized we could actually reframe it in that light. We could say, like, well, actually, you know, in our mono, we have this weekly deploy cycle. It takes, like, a long time to see changes. You know, actually, when services, teams can deploy anytime they want, they can move way faster. And I think the interesting point there is that is a value and is one of the reasons we were doing services, but it was not like in our top three. You know, probably we were looking at organizational accountability and a bunch of other reasons. But one of the lessons I really learned was, you know, you not that you're deceptive, but when you have something that you're trying to connect to their needs, you're highlighting the thing that's relevant to them, not necessarily what's relevant to you. So you're going to choose the fastest thing that matters. Now, of course, we had eroded credibility, so we also had to rebuild that as well.
Yeah. How do you know what matters to somebody? We didn't practice this question, so it might be a little, you know, curveball, but how do you know? Like, how do you find out?
I think if you're curious and ask lots of questions, you can find out. It's not super hard to actually, like, I mean, even with technical executives, you should, when there's something that comes to them, you ask them why, and then you ask them the why of the why. That usually can dig down to what actually matters, or you can start to get a different angle on it, like understand, okay, what happened prior? Is there some historical, some past, you know, experiences leading you to the moment?
So what I'm getting from you there is a degree of openness to who they are, what their challenges are, and
absolutely,
and really, really, really trying to understand what's happening.
Yeah, typically you see, I think this is common, engineering, you know, talks to someone, they get an answer they don't like, and then you immediately make an assumption about like, okay, they're saying this because of this. And I think that's dangerous. If you basically are willing to say, actually, no, let me understand why they're actually having this problem. Why are they saying the thing they're saying? I'm not going to assume that it's because of, and maybe you're right, but a good chunk of time you're not correct. There's something else going on if you keep digging. This is a skill you should have as a leader in general with your own team, but you're going to practice that on other leaders as well.
The other thing that's occurring to me as we're talking is that once you get to the executive level, and we're primarily talking there in these examples, the other people you're talking to have 10, 15, 20 years of very, very, very deep experience, and so do you. And so they know a ton of stuff that you don't, and you cannot fully understand their world.
Yeah, and don't make that mistake. You know, I think you, as an engineer, we obviously can deal with huge amounts of complexity. Most of the time when leaders have gotten to that level, they also are really, really damn smart, just in a different field.
Exactly.
Spend some time with like your general counsel or like, you know, chief legal officer. They know as much about the law and encyclopedic knowledge as you probably do about engineering. It's pretty impressive.
Yep.
It's super important to remember that they are, and actually that's one actually trap door I fell into a couple times was a few times when, and what I did with Ken, the CEO, was I basically gave him a metaphor. Metaphors I learned are generally a bad idea when you're dealing with these executives because most good leaders have built mental models to understand the world. You know, there's too much complexity to deal with it directly. So if you give them something that looks like a model, but it's really like, falls apart when you poke on it, you basically like give them something that it's not going to survive, you know, the first conversation because they're going to want to understand more. So I try, if I'm going to, I'll give them an abstraction, but I won't actually give them a metaphor of like, we did one around like a car. Oh, we're going to be driving the Tesla now. And like, well, I don't want the Tesla, I want the Prius. Like, that's the kind of conversation you have.
Yeah, nice. I want the motorbike. Okay, let's switch gears a little bit because you also mentioned credibility. So
Absolutely. How
do you generate? How do you build your own credibility? How do you generate credibility? How do you do it without having to spend a year?
As a leader, you have to build credibility, but there's also things you can do until you build credibility. So maybe we'll talk about both those a little bit.
Yep.
I think we're doing all right on time. So
we're doing fine on time. Yeah.
Yeah. So building credibility. Realistically, I've learned that there's two main things as a leader that build credibility. One is deliver on your commitments. Like engineering, like we're responsible for the execution, right? We're responsible for the organization working. So if you're just known as someone who says, this will get done, it will get done by this time, you properly set expectations about what happens, and they feel there's accountability to it, and you just consistently have that delivery, you know, consistently delivering on commitments or owning up accountability when it's not, that builds a lot of credibility. That takes time, obviously. The other thing that I think is really helpful to build credibility, and by the way, there's some traps in that too, we can talk about that, but the other thing that tends to build credibility is, you know, a lot of these non-technical executives have problems where engineering can help. And so if you can be in a position to actually help them, and when they specifically want help, not when they're asking for help, not when they just need help, that also really builds credibility because they see you as a partner and not just as the person who, you know, runs the engineers that build the machines that's half the company and half of our, you know, headcount expense.
Right, I think it's a good point. I mean, one of the big steps from director to VP, or particularly if you're going on the exec staff level, is this notion that your ability to run the organization is table stakes, right?
So, absolutely.
So it's expected that you deal with that. You're now expected also to have a view of the company as a whole. You're expected to have opinions that are valid about business issues, and you're expected to help your peers
absolutely.
Who may be in domains that you know very little about.
One mistake I made there actually was, you know, sometimes you see a peer who's really struggling and you know how to help them solve. if they aren't really, really receptive to help, it's generally not a good idea to help them because it just doesn't, it feels like you're stepping on their toes. Yep. And this, you know, stepping on your lane. So what I've generally done with that is I've done stuff like, hey, you know, this, you know, sounds like you're having some problems. You know, this sounds like a problem I dealt with before. Do you want to talk about it? Gauge how receptive they are and see if you can take it further. If they're like, no, I got it, I'm good. Then sometimes you're coming back when the stuff is really down and then you kind of ask again. But that's actually a better way to approach it. Otherwise, if you're kind of just jumping in there with the moment you see a problem, which is a great, you know, it's a great trait, there's a perception that you're kind of like, you know, you're basically just trying to get step into their territory, and that can cause problems as well.
Yeah. Okay, so this may be obvious, but we'll ask it anyway. Why is this important? Why is it necessary in this role to have this skill set?
So, I mean, I think it's probably pretty obvious in general that you need to be able to influence and build tools for influence. I think it's extra important to think about the non-technical executive side. So, you know, most of the companies that we've had, you know, for a while, the sort of the marquee companies tended to be pure tech companies. They're the Googles of the world, they're the Facebooks of the world. There was a large trend where those were the kind of dominant, where most of your partners were engineering partners. Now you're seeing a lot of the companies today are basically taking technology to transform the real world, whether that's in finance or retail, logistics or transportation. And in those companies, you're going to be dealing with a lot of non-technical executives. So I think, and obviously, actually, as you go up in leadership anyway, you're going to encounter more of them. But it's even more prominent in the non-pure tech companies.
Excellent. Great. So I think we're going to head to audience questions, right?
Because I have one more thing I want to mention. So I want to mention one more thing about sort of what you do until you've built credibility. Because I think, it's just worth pointing out. So there's some time where you won't have enough credibility in the organization, or you just don't have credibility in the area. So how do you get proxy credibility is kind of how I think about it. So I'll give you an example of a technique. I had to get this project funded. I realized that my major opponent or the person who could blow me up in this would be the CFO. So I was like, okay, I have to get the CFO on board.
He's not your opponent, he's a partner.
Yes, well, yeah, he was a partner, but you know, he was the one who could potentially make this work or not work. So the CTO would have my back, the CFO, you know. So he cared about top-line revenue, so I built a case that sort of laddered this engineering effort up into revenue. But I don't have credibility, I have credibility as an engineering leader, but not as a finance guy. So what I did was I actually partnered with his most trusted lieutenant to actually make sure that the finance, the numbers look good. So you're basically getting proxy credibility by working with a trusted lieutenant. Then he can basically, I knew exactly what happened after I presented it. He pinged his guy and he's like, hey, have you seen the proposal of Scott's? He's like, oh yeah, it looks, checks out, looks good. You know, so that was one way to get proxy credibility.
Nice.
Another way to do it is just being data driven, right? So most people respond well to data. So if you have a good way to actually bring in data externally, you know, that can help argue your case, that works in some cases as well. The third thing, and I think most of you probably know what that looks like. I think the third way that I've typically done this is often you don't have credibility for the big thing, but you have a lesser credibility to run like a trial or a POC of something. So I wanted to do some big change. I don't have enough credibility to basically get signed off this huge effort. So I'm like, well, let me do a small investment to prove this technology or to prove the decision I want to make. And then when you do that, you stack the deck in your favor. You put the best team on it. You put on the best possible problem. Yep. You're basically biasing that for success. And and then, of course, when it's successful, you're like, look, and they were using this technology. Look how successful they were. You know, and
proof is good.
Yeah, the proof is good. You've kind of like, you're kind of highlighting like that, even though there's probably a bunch of other reasons it's successful. You're basically really building the case that, you know, this technology was a big aspect of the success, and that kind of then builds credibility on that area.
Nice. Great. Okay, we're going to move to some of these questions. I'm sorry, that's from behind me. Okay. Anonymous says, how do you tell micromanaging execs to back off and not dive into areas they don't have expertise in? Anonymous, you can see me afterwards and I'll give you a hug.
Yeah.
I hope everything's okay.
So this is a pretty common problem. I think you kind of want to get to the heart of like why. The first question is why are they really getting involved in something they don't have expertise in? There's a reasonable chance they actually have some concern and some problem that you're not addressing, you know, in the organization.
That's right.
You know, so, you know, you have to look in the mirror and be like, okay, what am I not doing? And so spend some time with the exec, figure out what their actual, same with empathy, it's empathy. Get down to the heart of what they are. Now there's a chance they're just like, they can't help but meddle. And there's ways to deal with people who just want to meddle. It's kind of a separate topic. But most of the time what I found is they have some genuine concern and they want to be involved. So then you figure out how to bring them into that. Sometimes that just means, they want some input into decision making and you just decide on the level of abstraction to give them. So they want some input, I'll give them two choices, for example. I'll give them a trade-off choice. Right. That way they feel like they've had some input and I'm okay with either of those outcomes.
Yeah, I think one of the ways I tend to think about it that is there's a specific ask, which will be something very specific, like all the engineering teams should have seven people in them, or at least seven people.
Sure.
And it's, you know, that's actually a stupid thing to ask for. But there's some other question there.
Absolutely.
Right? So like maybe it's reliability, maybe it's redundancy. There's something that
you have to get to the bottom of what they're really looking for.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm gonna take the second one down first. This is, do you have any tips? It's a similar question actually. Do you have any tips for dealing with an exec who thinks more highly of their technical skills than others? Brackets, you do.
So I can talk through an example I've had where we've had execs that were, in some area, they felt like they were really an expert, and they probably were at some point, but the organization has scaled dramatically. Now it's hard for their ideas to necessarily apply to the business as a whole. And this could be, by the way, in technical and product and business, whatever. So one trick I did for this, actually, this is a specific technique, was I'm like, well, they just want to be heard. They want to feel like they have influence and interaction. So One of the teams I built was an experimentation team. So that part of what we did was like outlet for crazy exec ideas. We literally like, there's a crazy exec idea. This team can be super fast. They can build it and, you know, run a prototype and launch in a week.
It's fun.
And it turns out some of those crazy exec ideas were actually good ideas. So that's one sort of way to get outlet for that, is to do it in a way that's less risky for the business, because sometimes they just want to feel still connected. The other way is try and get them involved in a way where they're not actually, they can't do damage. Basically, they can just contribute feedback or advice, and there's some context around that.
You give them a psychological padded room of some sort.
Yes.
Okay. One more. Great. How do you influence execs to foster a culture conducive for engineering teams in a sales or revenue-driven business? So the priority of what I'm getting from this is the organization's priority is sales and revenue rather than
the engineering
building stuff.
Well, I mean, they've just told you what that matters to them. What matters to them is revenue, sales. So I think if you're in a non-technology business, I think I haven't done that, so that's a bit harder. But if you're a tech company, even if it's sales or revenue driven, usually the work your engineering team is doing directly can be directly driving either top or bottom line, you know, revenue, or it can directly affect sales. So in that case, what you're really trying to do is like, okay, well, they've told me what's important to me. How do I just connect the work my teams are doing to that? And you know, in the case of revenue, you can basically build models around even stuff like latency and what that costs on the business. And you can build a latency sensitivity analysis and collect the data. With sales, I mean, a lot of times that's what their most important customers are looking for. So then you're doing the same kind of work. You're basically helping them in the area that they care about.
Yeah.
But engineering, and that doesn't have to be all of engineering, but that's like you can take some amount of that to basically push, to align all the stuff you need to do in that sort of framework.
Yeah, I mean, to some extent, they're making your life a little easier by telling you what.
Exactly,
they
that's what they care about. So you just have to figure out how to frame your work, because if you're an engineering company, you're driving those things. How to frame that work in that lens?
Okay, so how are we doing for time? Where's my time person?
We're done with time, unfortunately.
That's what I figured. It's got a great question down here. How do I kick my VP in a nice way out the door and say no? It's just like, those of you who want to discuss that later.
If that's something from Credit Karma, I'm happy to talk with you afterwards.
Yeah. And on that note, thank you very much. Warm round of applause for our speakers today.